Penguin Random House Audio presents The Beggar's Pawn by John LaRue, read for you by Robert Fass. For our friend Deborah Treisman. Part 1. Chapter 1. They first met Reginald Parker ages ago, in the innocent part of the year 2001, before disaster struck at the World Trade Center and the Pentagon and an empty field in Shanksville, Pennsylvania, at a time when it was still possible to think ours was a virtuous country and everyone liked us, and terrorists were just a plot complication in the movies. We had no idea then what forms terrorism could take, at home and away, in that innocent time ages ago. Anyhow, they met Reginald Parker while they were out walking their new puppy, Dickens. They were David and Maggie Holliss, and Dickens was not actually their puppy, but their son, Sedge's. They were dog-sitting for Dickens while Sedge went through the ritual of getting a divorce. It was his fourth divorce, and the Hollisses were not happy about it. But they liked the puppy, and they were pleased when Reginald Parker stopped them and said, "What a wonderful little dog. What do you call him?" "He's still a puppy," Maggie said, "but he's house-trained." This was partly true. "We call him Dickens," David said.
"Dickens as in Charles, or as in he's a little Dickens?"
"Charles, I think," Maggie said. "He's got a bookish look to him, that little face. He's part Labrador Retriever."
"Well, he's a wonderful little dog, puppy."
He scratched the dog's ears and then the soft fur on his chest.
"Good Dickens. Nice Dickens."
He smiled at them as David tugged lightly at the leash.
"So long, Dickens."
They were on their way to the local dog park, and when they were safely out of earshot, Maggie said,
"He seems very nice."
"His hair is too long," David said, "and he's intrusive."
"He's good-looking in a way," Maggie said.
"He needs a shave."
Maggie gave him one of her looks. "I thought he seemed very nice," she said. That was how they first met Reginald Parker. They met him for the second time a few days later, again while they were taking Dickens to the dog park.
"My old friend Dickens," he said,
and knelt down beside the dog to fondle his ears. Dickens gave a tentative lick to his face. Reginald had not shaved since they last met.
"I didn't realize why he was called Dickens," Reginald said. "I didn't realize you were Professor Holliss. I should have, though. Practically everybody around here is a professor of something or other. But I didn't put two and two together, your specialty and the dog's name."
"Are you growing a beard?" David asked.
"It's very becoming," Maggie said. "Or it will be."
Reginald stood up and fingered his bristly chin.
"I'm a writer," he said. "I figured it goes with the territory."
"A writer," Maggie said. "Yes, yes. What do you write?"
"I'm working on a novel right now."
"A novel?"
Maggie looked at David, who said nothing.
"How exciting."
"Well, I haven't published yet," Reginald said. "You know what the publishing industry is like these days. Nobody wants novels. All they want is memoirs of my life as a drug addict."
"Oh, dear," Maggie said.
"Not my life. I've never been a drug addict. Not really, I mean. I mean, that's the kind of thing they want. You must find that too in your field, Professor Holliss. No?"
"No. Nobody wants to know about my drug addiction."
They all laughed, nervous, and Dickens barked as if he understood.
"I'm Reg Parker," Reginald said, sticking out his hand. "And you're Professor Holliss, I know. And you must be Mrs. Holliss."
They shook hands and said hello. "Yes, hello."
"I'm a great admirer of your work on Dickens," Reginald said.
"Thackeray, you mean," David said. "My only work on Dickens is trying to get him not to pee on the kitchen floor."
David Holliss was known for his work on Thackeray and had been briefly famous for his work on Stephen Crane. But now, late in his career,
It was Thackeray whom people seemed to remember, though they often confused him with Dickens.
Thackeray, of course. I meant Thackeray. Sorry about that.
People do that all the time. Maybe it means I should work on Dickens.
He's working on Gissing now, Maggie said. Gissing?
New Grub Street Gissing. The writer is a kind of production line worker. Poverty, desperation. She paused. The long climb from lower middle to upper middle class. It's great stuff.
Maybe we could talk about your writing sometime, Reginald said. I'd like that.
David took a step backward. Thanks for the offer, but I never talk about writing while it's in progress. Foolish of me, probably, but I just don't. Besides, I'm still doing research. But thanks, and good luck with the novel. I admire anybody who undertakes a novel. It's like signing up for, well, I don't know what. A suicide mission, I guess. We've got to get moving. As if on command, Dickens bolted after a squirrel and was tugged back by his leash. See, David said. And so they left Reginald Parker and continued their walk.
A suicide mission, Maggie said.
Nosy Parker, David said. They walked in silence for a while, pausing to let Dickens savor all the delicious smells left by other dogs. Good boy, David said as Dickens lifted his leg on a holly bush.
You weren't very friendly, Maggie said.
He's lonely is all.
Poor soul, Maggie said.
David said nothing until they got home. Then he said what he had kept himself from saying during the whole long walk. You shouldn't have told him about Gissing. My work is private. You know that.
I'm sorry.
I'm still researching. I still haven't read all his novels. Who knows, I may never write the damned book.
I've said I'm sorry.
It's too late to be sorry.
If you can hold on a minute, I'll go and kill myself.
Do you see what he's caused, that Parker? We're fighting, and we never fight. That man is trouble. But Parker wasn't trouble, at least not then, in the innocent part of the year 2001. After that one conversation, he seemed to understand that David's writing was off limits, and so he let it alone. The dog, however, was not only a safe topic, it was a welcome one. Over the next months, the three of them met often on their morning walks. Dickens would bound forward, tugging at the leash, eager for the pats and chest rubs of his new bearded friend.
I just love this dog, Reginald said.
I'm surprised you don't get one of your own, Maggie said. They make a morning walk a lot more enjoyable. She had come to the conclusion that he was a bachelor, starving for his art, and he needed a dog as a companion. On the other hand, perhaps his morning walks were in service of his novel, a kind of thinking time before he sat down to write, and so a dog might prove to be a distraction. She'd have liked to ask him about this, but she worried that any talk of writing would lead to a question about David's work on Gissing, and thus to unhappiness at home.
I could never afford a dog, Reginald said. Not a beauty like Dickens. Could I, Dickens? No, I couldn't. Never.
And he gave the dog a firm pat on the behind. Later, Maggie said to David, he could never afford a dog. That's what he said. David recognized the tone and could tell she was thinking of buying him one.
Don't, he said. Let sleeping dogs, etc.
One day, when David was not feeling up to a walk, he had thrown his back out while putting on his shoes, Maggie took Dickens to the park by herself, and, as she thought she might, she ran into Reginald Parker. He was walking with his head down, apparently lost in thought, and it was only when Dickens poked his cold nose into Reginald's hand that he looked up, surprised, and greeted them both.
Thinking of your book? Maggie asked.
Book? He said. He looked confused.
The novel, she said.
And then, I always forget. Writers don't like to talk about their work in progress. She noticed that his pupils were dilated, as if he were on something, and she remembered Sedge when he was high on grass. I was a friend of Iris Murdoch, Reginald said.
Really? How exciting. Did she talk about...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.